to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near.
We praise you. no place in this place. Praise Him. Praise Him. Yeah.
Wow, so good to praise the Lord together here in the Lord's house on the Lord's Day. Well, my name is John Smith. I'm one of the pastors here. You can have a seat. And, you know, God has been so good to our church. And I just want to take a little time to just remind us of where we were at in our financial situation in December and to see God's faithfulness and God's goodness and the provision that He made for us as a church. Well, on December 31st, as we started the day, we were almost $390,000 in the need. And you know what? You showed up. God showed up. And as a church, I just want to give you an update of all the ways that God provided for us on that day. And so we were $396,000 short. We prayed, God provided, and we have this to rejoice over. We almost made it to the end. God showed up, and we were $4,181 shy of that amazing goal that we had, which is going to allow us as a church to think about all the ministry that we have in these days ahead and in 2021 and looking forward to seeing what God is going to do. So as a church, why don't we just continue with that theme? Let's give the Lord a big hand. Let's praise the Lord.
Wow, is that not great news? I'm so glad you were here to hear that really wonderful news. What a faithful God we have. He's so personal and just has provided for us in such beautiful ways. So welcome this weekend to the Harvest Bible Chapel online. We're really glad that you're with us. My name is Lynn. I work over at the Elgin campus in women's ministry, and I'm pretty excited about being your online host today because there's so many amazing things to tell you about. So before I jump into all of those things, I want to make sure that those of you who are new, you're visiting with us for the first time, we just want you to know how really glad we are that you landed here, and we do hope and pray that you join us again next week. Well, whether you are new or whether you've been here for a super long time, would you take a second and just check in? It helps us to know that you're here. You can do it right on your phone. It's super simple, and you can do it online as well. We appreciate it. Well, Harvest students, this message is for you. I just want you to know if you're in junior high or if you're in high school, I want to make sure you know that there's a new series starting really soon in your ministry. It's called Blind Faith. And I actually was just talking to Pastor Tommy about this, and he's so passionate about you helping you guys understand what you believe and why you believe it. It's really going to be awesome. So I hope and pray that you can attend either live on your campuses or attend online. You can find out more details at harvestnow.info. Well, I also am very excited to tell you that Pastor Eddie Hoagland is going to be starting a new series today. His three-week series is called Yes, I Will. And you know, so many of us are going through such difficult things that this series is going to be super timely because he's going to walk us through some scriptures that help us understand who God is and how he's going to help us go through these challenging circumstances that we're living through. So I pray that you can come back next week and join us for part two. Well, right now we have a video for you that just shows amazing highlights, more of what God has done for us in 2020. praise God for what he's doing. Can you believe it? And here's another a really exciting thing he's doing on three of our campuses, Meadows and Elgin and Crystal Lake. Next weekend is a super important weekend. We're opening what we're calling Hope Centers. These are gonna be, they're kind of like stores, and they're filled with food and hygiene products for people in our communities, people in our church that are in need. And so we're praying that they will not only feel the love of Jesus here, but they'll also be provided for in a very practical way. And if I could just say to all of you who brought food at the Christmas event we had right before Christmas, that come and see the Christmas lights experience, it was in our video, you guys blew us away. That box truck was so full that we had to have all the staff help unload it and sort it and get it ready to ship out to the other campuses. So praise God for you guys. God really moved really powerfully. Well, speaking of hope, we want to make sure you know that there are a bunch of online classes. We're calling this Hope for 2021. In fact, there's a bunch of them. There's six of them. I want to tell you the names of each one of those. All of them are going to point you to the hope of Jesus, but they're all very specific to maybe something that you're working through or are interested in. So for example, the classes are hope for my marriage, hope for my family, hope in my finances, hope in my struggles, and then there's one called Hope in Jesus. If you want to find out more about who he is and what he's done for you, please, please hop on to one of these classes. And then the last one is called Habits of Hope that will just help you lay out kind of a Bible reading plan that will just make a huge difference for your 2021. So I know that's a lot of information. You can go on harvestnow.info. You can register. You can find out all the information you need. We pray that that's a real blessing to you. Well, once again, I just want to say that it's been a privilege to stand up here and just acknowledge the unbelievable blessing of the Lord. And he's worked through you guys. He's worked through you to give of your time, your talents, and your treasures. So I just want to make sure going forward, you know there's four ways you can give. You can give through your Harvest app on your phone. You can give through online Harvest Bible Chapel. You can give through a text. And you can also give by just sending in your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. We're so thankful for any and all of those. We're so glad that you landed here, and we pray that you come back next week as well.
The same God who never fails will not fail me now. Won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who never late is working all things out. Working all things out. Everybody say yes, I will lift you up. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy. All my days. Yes, I will. Woo!
So good to be back in worship.
Same God who never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. That same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out. And we say yes, lift you high. Oh,
If you got a yes in your spirit, make some noise in here.
This is a house of worship.
That's right.
This is a place of praise.
Yeah.
Where every demon trembles. Where we proclaim your name. This is a house of healing. Our hearts are full of faith. 'Cause you have our full attention. And you have the final say. So come alive. In the name of Jesus, come alive. In the name of Jesus, this is a house of miracles. And we bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. Resurrection power. Your blood runs through our veins.
Yes, it does.
Your kingdom triumphs over even the coldest grave. So we sing, come alive. Come alive in the name of Jesus. Come on. This is a house of miracles. And we bring everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles.
Proclaim it this morning.
We sing, come alive in the name of Jesus. Come alive. Everything to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracles. I still believe you're moving. I still believe you're speaking. God, I believe you're working all things for good. I fix my eyes on heaven. God,
oh.
bring everything right to the feet of Jesus. Everything in the name of Jesus. This is a house of miracle. Miracles. I believe it. Do you believe it? Do you believe that God answers prayer? Church, do you believe that God answers prayer?
Yes.
I believe you do. But God can do miracles as well. And the difference between a miracle and just an outcome to a prayer is God can be the only one who does a miracle.
Yes, yes, yes.
And we are a church that should be praying for miracles in our lifetime, in our nation, in our lives, in our homes, in our workplaces. And to be a house of miracles, we need to be a house of prayer. Yeah. Matthew 21, verse 13, Jesus says, my house will be a house of prayer.
Yes, yes.
And so, church, I call us to prayer right now. To bring to mind a thing that you are praying for a miracle over. For yourself, for someone that you love. Like Pastor John said, for our nation, we pray for a miracle. Yeah. That our nation would rise up and come alive in the name of Jesus. So whether you just want to stand, or whether you want to sit, or whether you even want to just get in the aisle and take a knee, let us pray right now for that miracle that you brought to mind. My house, Jesus said, will be a house of prayer. Let's pray right now. Let's go. Where there is judgment, would there be compassion? Where there is strife, would there be peace? Where there is hate, would there be love? Where there is injustice, God, would we see your righteousness? For Psalm 20 says, some trust in chariots and some in horses. But we trust in the name of the Lord our God. Despite what we see, Lord, despite what we feel, despite what we hear, we know that we can trust you, and we choose to place our trust and our faith and our hope in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We know that you are a strong tower. We know that you are a refuge for the broken. We know that you are a shield around the righteous. So would you show yourself strong in the events of this country, in the events of what we are praying for miracles for? Would you repair what appears to be beyond repair? Would you move mountains that have yet to be moved? Would you heal cancer, marriages, brokenness? In the name of Jesus, would Jesus Christ be the only banner that is lifted high above us, above this church, and would you be glorified in the lives of these people and in our country and in our world? And in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen.
You are the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, how revealed in you are, Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, our King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, you brought heaven down. Oh, my sin was great, your love was greater.
of miracles right now. A house of prayer.
Amen.
And all God's people said, amen.
Amen. You can take a seat.
Everybody, how you doing? You doing good? It is good to see you in 2021 as we gather to worship Jesus Christ, whether in person or if you're watching online. We're glad you're here. Today we begin a new series called Yes, I Will. And if you don't know why we're calling that Yes, I Will, it's because Yes, I Will is one of the songs that was birthed in this church. And way before there was a band called Vertical Worship, this church had already had a high value in what it meant to worship Jesus Christ. And so there was this thing called harvest songs. I wonder if some of you remember that, where we would record albums, right, with original songs and also just songs that were significant in our church's history. And then after harvest songs, we came into a relationship with Provident Label Group back in 2012, and that's when Vertical Church Band started. That was that initiative. And, a few years later, we just renamed it. It's the same band called Vertical Worship. And we've done 6 albums over the course of these years. And I look at these albums, and I remember every single one of those recordings. I remember being in the room and sensing God's presence as we lifted high the name of Jesus. When I look at that orange album, I think of Open Up the Heavens. And then I think Rock Won't Move. I think Spirit of the Living God. And Exalted Overall, and it's that next album, Bright Faith, Bold Future, that we released in 2018. That's where we recorded Yes, I Will. And I'm just going to be honest, we had no idea what God was about to do. We just didn't. We were just, we're going to keep recording the songs that God puts on our heart and births in this church. We're just going to keep doing that. But God had something he wanted to do through that song. And here we are 3 years later after releasing it. And it's still on the radio across many radio stations across the country. It actually peaked at being the number 3 song on the Christian radio chart in 2019, which is amazing. And currently, get this, it's the 29th most sung song in churches in America today. I mean, it's unbelievable. There's a company that actually tracks that, and they have churches submit what's the songs that they're singing on the weekends, and right now it's number 29 and continues to climb. And then it was nominated for a Dove Award in 2019. And on top of all that, it's been covered by many artists, including KB and Anthony Evans, just to name a couple. And while all that is exciting, and it is exciting because that's something that started right here, but our heart is to use whatever platform God gives us for his glory and to minister to others. That's what we want to use our platform for. And that's what you should want to use your platform for. And you might say, Eddie, I don't have a platform. No, you do. Every single one of you has a platform. God has given you influence in some area, whether it's at your work, in your school, in your family. You each have a platform, and we should each be using our platform for God's glory and to minister to others. Man, I remember leading that song for the first time up in Crystal Lake where I was the worship leader. Shout out to my Crystal Lake peeps. Love you guys. I remember as soon as we sang it the first time, just seeing the congregation just embrace it, just jump on. You can really feel that as a worship leader when the congregation embraces a song. And then we started touring the song across all the nation and seeing how the Lord was using it there. But one of the things that really stood out to me was, I think it was last year, we sent the band out on a Christmas tour, which I didn't go on. And when they came back, the stories that they came back with were all about how God had used Yes, I Will to really encourage people who were going through a really difficult time in their lives. And, when the song first came out, I didn't think that that was the path that the Lord was going to use the song. I didn't realize that it was going to minister to so many people who were in a really difficult place. And clearly, God has been using this song to remind people of the truth of Scripture. And he's been using this song to stir their faith, to build up their faith, but to put it into action. So this series is about studying and identifying just some of the biblical principles that are in this song, because more than a song, more than a band, more than a musical style, God will bless his word. God will bless his word. If the truths come from this book, which is the authority that we all stand under, God will bless it because it's his word, and his word does not return void. So this week we're going to begin in Psalm 23. If you want to turn there, it's kind of in the middle of your Bible, and look for the Psalms and then chapter 23. It's a very popular psalm, and this is where we're going to be spending our time this first week in this series with the first message, I will walk through the valley. I will walk through the valley. Let me pray for us as we get started. Father, I just take a moment right here and I ask that you would be the one who moves and who speaks to us. Lord, I ask that as we read your word that we would be encouraged, that we would be called to action, that we would respond to what you're saying to us. But God, also, at the same time, I'm asking that you would refresh us and comfort us. We ask for both those things today, and we ask them in the name of your Son. Amen. Amen. All right, Psalm 23. Let me just give you a little bit of context before we get to verse 4, which is where this message comes from. So let's just start in verse 1. Verse 1 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake." So David is writing the psalm. David says, "The Lord is my shepherd." So here he uses the word Lord, which is the word Yahweh, which that is God's covenant name. That's the name God uses when he's in relationship with his people. And that relational God is his shepherd. That is a beautiful picture that should encourage many of us today. He's our shepherd, because the job of the shepherd with his sheep is to guide, it's to protect, it's to correct at times, but it's also to care for his sheep. And when David thinks about the job of a shepherd, he says, "The Lord is my shepherd." What an amazing thing that the God of the universe is the one who's going to protect you, that he's the one who wants to care for you. He's the one who wants to correct you and to guide you as your shepherd. No wonder he can say, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," right? That means that he's not going to need anything because he's under the care of this shepherd. And look at all the good things that come from the shepherd. You can see that in verse 2 and 3, right? He makes me lie down in green pastures. That means that God is going to lead you to find rest. And I know some of you need that today. You need rest. But the Lord is your shepherd, and he will lead you to rest at times. He will pull you out of the chaos and place you beside still waters. Not raging waters. He's going to put you right by the still waters, pulling you out of the chaos. And then he's going to make you holy. He's going to let you find those paths of righteousness, changing your heart, changing your desires. And he's going to make you holy for his name's sake, for his glory. But that will lead to your joy. So that's verses 1 through 3. Look at all the good things that come from the shepherd. But then this verse, verse 4, says, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." So this week we're going to spend our time camping on that phrase, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." Because here's the thing, you're not only going to be beside still waters as the Lord is your shepherd, you're also going to go through some valleys in your life. And valleys are a picture of what's difficult, what those dark places are for you, and you're going to have to walk through those at times. So this is a really simple message that I want to share with you today, but hear me, it's really, really practical and helpful, and it's profound if you're willing to embrace what's inside this phrase, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. So if you know the title of the sermon, you know the outline. Real simple, okay? So the title of the sermon is the outline. 3 points. Here's the first point. I will walk. I will walk. I will walk. So the verse starts with even though, and that in Hebrew is the word gam. And when the psalmist uses the word gam, he's connecting the concept of in addition to. So he's adding to, he's accumulating to what he just said. So he just said all the good things that the shepherd brings. And he's saying, and in addition to that, in addition to all the good stuff, I'm also going to walk through the valley. Those things aren't separate. It's both those things. If you are a sheep that belongs to this good shepherd, you're going to have all these good things from God and enjoy them, but you're also going to be walking through some valleys. So the first thing I notice in that phrase, even though I walk, is the who's walking. So even though I walk, who's the person walking? It's not a trick question. I wasn't trying to trick you. Who's the person walking? I am. Yes, I'll cheat on the test. The answer is I'm walking. All right, here we go. Who's the person walking? Okay, great. You are walking. You have to walk, even though I walk. Now, stay consistent with the picture that's right here in Psalm 23. Could a shepherd reach down to one of his sheep, pick it up, and put the sheep over his shoulders and then walk through the valley? Of course the shepherd could, but he doesn't. He says that the sheep, David, is saying, I, as the sheep, I'm the one who's going to walk through the valley. There's something in there for you. The fact that you have a responsibility to walk. Now, hear me. The shepherd's going to be with you, and that is awesome. But he still expects you to walk. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. So what does that mean? What does it mean to walk? Well, I know it means two things. The first thing I know it means is it means don't run. Don't run. To run in the valley represents not exhibiting that confidence that you should have, that God has you in this valley for a reason. So you start frantically just taking matters into your own hands and doing everything you can to get out of that valley as soon as possible. Running means you're striving and you're doing things on your own strength. And if that's the case, hear me, you're not going to make it. If you're running, you're not going to make it through the valley. You will run yourself into the ground because you're running instead of walking. See, walking means being patient. Walking means trusting that there's a reason why God has you in this valley. Even if you don't understand it. Even if you don't get why it's happening. Because sometimes, in hindsight, I get to see why God put me in a valley. Can you relate to that? Where you kind of get through it, and then you're like, wow, look at all the things God did. I kind of understand why I walked through that. But there are many times I do not get that understanding. I walk out of it, and I'm like, I'm so glad I'm out of it. And I don't understand why I had to go through there. But I trust that God had a reason. I trust that there was a reason why he put me through that. And if you're demanding that God explain every single valley to you, I would suggest to you that you might be running. You might be running and not walking. Because when you walk through the valley, you will find peace. But you're not going to find it in the valley. You're going to find it in your shepherd. And in the valley, you're going to find joy, but you're going to find that joy in the shepherd. And in the valley, you are going to find strength to keep going in the shepherd himself. That's how you're going to be able to walk. So it means don't run. And secondly, it means don't stop. If you're going to walk through the valley, you can't stop. There's some of you here today that you've stopped in the valley. And you're reaching that point of despair, maybe. And it's not really because of how dark the valley is. It's because you've stopped walking and your perspective isn't changing. Because you look around in the valley and all you see is the same picture, the same darkness. And if you want to experience a new perspective, If you want to leave church today with a different vision than what you walked in with today, you got to keep walking. You can't stop, because when you're stopped in the valley, it all looks exactly the same, and that's what will lead you to stop losing hope. So if you want to gain that hope, you just got to keep walking. So let's get practical. What does that mean if you're in the valley and it's like, what do I need to do to keep walking? Well, it means these three things. Prioritize these three things, and that's how you know that you're still walking, that you keep walking. First, be in God's presence. Be in God's presence. So the first thing, and all three of these things you're going to be able to apply in our weekly gatherings by prioritizing that, whether in person or if you're watching online, but you're also going to be able to apply them personally. Be in God's presence. We just experienced God's presence here today. As we lifted high the name of Jesus, he was here and he was present, not like in the same way he's always present, but in a special way he's moving. He's showing himself, he's evidencing himself, and so we prioritize gathering with God's people because it's where we spend time in God's presence. But it's not just here on the weekend, it's also during the week where we're praising God in our cars, we're praising God in our kitchen, we're praising God at work, and we're singing songs, and we're just speaking words, and praise can be all those things because we want to be in God's presence as his sheep. And if you want to keep walking, do everything you can to spend time in God's presence. Second thing it means is be in God's word. Be in God's word. Again, that's what we're doing right now. We're spending some time in God's word together. But you need to be doing this during the week. You need to have a personal time where you're spending time reading the Bible. And maybe for you that's a little, I don't know, just a little bit scary to say, well, I don't really know what I'm supposed to do. I mean, this is a pretty big book. And if that's you today, can I just encourage you, find someone and just ask them to help you with that. We would love to help you with that. Ask anyone who welcomes you into the worship center, or you can even text it into the chat. We want to help you be able to spend more time in God's word, because that's how you're going to keep walking. You're going to keep walking by being in God's presence and by spending time in God's word, where you're going to experience the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Third thing, you need to be with God's people. You have to be with God's people. Be in God's presence, be in God's word, and be with God's people. And I just wanted to address those who are watching online, and you haven't been able to gather since the beginning of all this pandemic back in March. And if that's you, can I just encourage you that, you know, optimally, someone should be reaching out to you, and you should still feel like you're connected to your church. But if that's not happening, can I encourage you to calendar connecting with God's people? That you would schedule a regular phone call with someone where you could speak about what the Lord's doing in your life, and that you could pray together, and just put it on your calendar. Make it a regular thing until you're able to gather again. Because if you're going to keep walking, you need to be with God's people. And you might ask, Eddie, where'd you get these things from? Well, they're just basic principles of what we know about sheep. Because sheep are in the shepherd's presence. They're guided by the shepherd. They're right next to the shepherd. So they spend time in the presence of the shepherd. And sheep know the shepherd's voice. When the shepherd guides and says this way, not that way, he can call out commands, and the sheep know his voice. That's why you have to be in God's word. This is how you're going to know his voice. You're going to get to know how this Holy Spirit speaks to you, because he's going to speak through this book to you. And sheep travel in flocks. That's why you got to be with God's people. We're going to make it through the valley together, because we're going to travel as a flock. And if you aren't prioritizing those three things, then you've stopped in the valley. And you need to keep walking. You need to keep walking. And look, I know this is a difficult word for some of you to receive. I know that because you're going through it right now. And, you know, I wish I had the time to sit down with each one of you and to spend time encouraging you to keep walking. But let me just, take a little bit of risk here in church today. Would anyone in, I don't know, anyone in this section in the middle be willing to express that if you're in that valley right now, and that this is resonating with you, that you're in the valley right now, would you be willing to just raise your hand? And let me just encourage you. I'm not going to ask you to do anything, but just raise your hand If you're walking through a valley right now, anyone. Okay, right here, third row. Could you just give me your first name?
Vida.
Vida?
Vida,
V-I-D-A. Vida. Vida, thank you for being honest in church today. I know that when you're in a valley, so many times you can just start thinking about, when's it going to end? And you want to get to the other side. And I'm going to talk about what the other side looks like here in a second, but here's my encouragement to you, Vida. Just keep walking. Okay? You have people around you who love you, and we want to do this together. Keep walking. And I wish I could say that to each one of you who's in the valley today. Keep walking. Keep walking. I will walk. And then point two, just one word, tell me what it is. Point two is through. I will walk through. We have to get rid of all this nonsense that's being said out there and taught out there that once you're a sheep of the shepherd, then that shepherd will always lead you around the valley, that you're never going to go through the valley. Life's not going to be difficult once you're a child of God. That is nonsense. You will go through the valley. That's going to happen. But being a part of sheep is the fact that you are going to walk through the valley. You will walk through the valley. That means two things, not around it. Not around it. God's not going to take you as a sheep and take you up on the hillside and say, see the valley down there, let me teach you about this and let me teach you about that. No. What God has decided to do is to take you as a sheep and to put you in the trenches of the valley. That's where he wants you to learn. And you can ask him why that's where he wants you to learn once you get to heaven. But he wants you there in the trenches. But here's the beautiful thing. He's going to be in there with you. The shepherd's not going to leave you there alone in the trenches of the valley. He's going to be there with you, but he wants you to not go around it. He wants you to go through it. And that means not around, through it. And it also means this. It also means from beginning to end. When you go through something, you didn't go through it until you reached the end. And you got to reach the end even if you can't see the end. You know, there's some valleys, you kind of look down the valley and then let's say there's a bend, you might not see the end of the valley. You have no idea when it's gonna come to an end. It kind of reminds me of this pandemic that we're going through, because everyone's like, well, once it's over, and I'm like, what? How am I gonna know it's over? Like, what triggers it being over? And it's just so confusing. And if one of the valleys for you has been having to walk through this, I don't know when the end is, but you are called to go through it all the way to the end. All the way to the end. It kind of reminds me of Acts chapter 27. You don't have to turn there. I'm just going to remind you of the story. In Acts chapter 27, Paul is headed to Rome, and then he ends up shipwrecked when he approaches the shore of this island called Malta. And it's a pretty amazing story, because Paul's a prisoner, and there's a centurion and soldiers, and there's other prisoners on this ship. And as they head towards the shore of Malta, the ship just starts falling apart, basically. So it hits the reef, the surf is crashing upon it, and then the soldiers are like, let's kill all the prisoners because they're going to get away. And the centurion's like, no, I don't want to kill Paul, so don't kill the prisoners. And so everybody just, you know, head over to the shore, and if you can swim, go ahead and swim that way. And if you can't swim, we'll just let the ship kind of fall apart and grab a piece of wood and hope you make it. And that's what's happening. It's really intense. Acts chapter 27, you can read it another time. And then they all make it. All the prisoners, all the soldiers, they make it to the shore of Malta. And then Acts chapter 28 in verse 1 starts by saying this. It says, after we were brought safely, you say it. After we were brought safely through, we learned that the island was called Malta. Now, imagine being one of those prisoners who didn't know how to swim, who had to grab a piece of wreckage to survive. You know, I have a friend who doesn't know how to swim, and he's, you know, in his mid-20s, and I tried to teach him how to swim one day, and so we're in the pool, and as I'm teaching him, man, he just turned into a different person as soon as he was in the water. Why? Because he was afraid, honestly afraid that he would drown. And when you know someone who doesn't know how to swim, or maybe you don't know how to swim, you realize what's happened here. You don't know how to swim, you fall into the ocean, and then you grab a piece of wood, somehow you make it to the shore, and you survive. And then, years later, some guy writes a book and has the audacity to say, after we were brought safely through. Safely? What are you talking about? I almost just died. And you want to say that I was brought safely through? To be brought safely through doesn't mean that it wasn't difficult. To be brought safely through, it doesn't mean that you were in danger. It means you're going to make it. It means you're going to make it to that shore. That's why he can say that they were brought safely through. And God is going to get you to the other side. God's going to get you to the other side of this valley. God's going to bring you safely through, no matter what your valley is. Maybe your valley is a physical illness, and you've been praying, God, get me through this valley. And he hasn't answered that yet. He hasn't healed you yet. Well, hear me. God's going to get you through this valley. He is going to get you through this valley. But now listen carefully. Listen to exactly what I'm saying. He's going to get you through this valley, and that might happen here on earth. But if it doesn't happen here on earth, he's going to take you to a land where there is no valleys at all. One day, you will be on the other side of the valley that you're in right now. It is going to come to an end, and Jesus will take you to the land of no valleys. So he'll either heal you here on earth, or he'll heal you on the other side of heaven. But if you're praying for it right now, you remember last year, maybe you remember I talked about what it means to pray in faith. And so if that's you here right now and you're praying for that healing, well, remember the three things I mentioned. You need to believe that God can do it. Then you need to trust him if he doesn't. But then you need to pray that he does. Do all three of those things. Those don't conflict at all. Believe that God can do it. He can. I've seen him do it. Of course he can do it. He has the power to heal you. Trust him if he doesn't. Trust him with the decision, not yourself. But then pray that he actually does it. Do those three things. But as you pray, even if he doesn't do it here, God's going to bring you safely through. Whatever your valley is, even if it's not a physical illness, listen, God is going to bring you safely through. I will walk through, and then point three, the valley. I will walk through the valley. Here, David uses the phrase, the shadow of death, which is it's a poetic Hebrew term, so it's a little bit wide in what it could mean. Of course, it could mean the shadow of death in the sense that such a great danger that it could lead to harm, it could lead to death. But it also could be metaphorical of just deep darkness, like the deepest darkness. Even though I walk through a valley that is in deep, deep darkness, and I think sometimes valleys can be because of the choices we make. Right, I've talked to some people and they're like, man, I just don't know why life is so hard. And I'm like, well, there's a few things you need to change about what you're doing. You know, how about we actually start trying to live out some of the things that Jesus taught? Maybe that'll lead us out of some valleys, right? To obey him, because we believe the things he said, so we want to obey him. And that happens sometimes. Sometimes you walk through valleys because of the choices you're making. But listen, sometimes, actually I would say many times, it has nothing to do with your sin. It has nothing to do with your sin or someone else's sin. You're in the valley because you're a sheep of the shepherd who has all these good things for you, but he's also going to be with you in the many valleys that you're going to walk through. Two verses come to mind when I think about this concept. The first I was thinking was John 16:33, where Jesus says to his disciples, I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. That in Jesus we may have peace. And then he says this, in the world you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. In the world you will have tribulation. What is Jesus teaching us? He's teaching us that valleys are to be expected. You're going to be walking through some valleys. If you are a disciple of Christ, who he's talking to, his 12 disciples, and in turn to us as his followers, you're going to be walking through some valleys in life. And so they're to be expected. It's coming. And then he says, but take heart, which is, you know, in common terms, we would kind of say like, but cheer up, don't go to despair. Why? That's telling us that valleys should not lead us to despair, but why? Because he says, I have overcome the world. the world in which valleys exist, Jesus Christ has triumphed over that world. And if you're going to take heart, if you're going to be encouraged today, you need to know that that encouragement comes through the fact that Jesus has overcome the world, and because he has triumphed over the world, every single valley will come to an end. Every single one is going to end one day. There is a day of no valleys coming in the future. Why can I say that? Because Jesus has overcome the world. He's the one who has the victory. He's the one who's triumphed. And then later, earlier in the book of John, the disciples are walking and they see a blind man who had been blind since birth. Talk about a valley. Imagine being blind since birth and at a time where there's no help. Like, we have a lot of technology that helps those who are blind right now. And imagine having none of that in this time. And he had been blind since birth, and the disciples ask him, well, is he blind because of his sin or because of his parents' sin? Doesn't that sound like us? When we're walking through a valley, we're like, God, is it because I did this? Or is it because they did this? Is it this sin? Well, it's always good to examine your heart and see if there's anything God's teaching you. But look, many times the answer is going to be no, it's not because of that. Just like this blind man. And Jesus answers in John chapter 9, verse 3, he says, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. Man, that's a word for someone today who's in a valley. It's not because of your sin. It's not because of someone else's sin. You're in this valley so that the works of God might be displayed in you. Listen, God has you in this valley. He's not punishing you. He's not condemning you by being in this valley. He's creating the space in your life. He's creating the opportunity for his power to shine in you. That's what he's doing. He's saying, I want this valley so that it's an opportunity where I will show up and I will show myself to be strong in you. You will have all the strength you need and you will give glory to God as you look at the landscape of your life someday. Only then, if you see God working in you and through you, will you be able to see valleys and mountaintops and say that it's beautiful. Not because you really enjoyed being in the valley. You might have enjoyed being on the mountaintop, but you can look at both those things in your life and say, that's beautiful because God showed up in both those places. God's not punishing you. God wants to show up. That's why he has you in this valley. And that's the call that the sheep have as they belong to the shepherd. Walk through the valley. So as I close, I want to share a story of a family in Omaha, Nebraska. This is a young family. And from left to right, that's Stephen and Levi. And then there's the parents, Christy and Jack. And then there are other two children, Abby and Hunter. And the young family, they're a military family. So they were moving around all throughout their lives and lived in a bunch of different places, and you know, that leads to many times a family finding a circle of friendship inside the family because you're the ones moving together everywhere. So they're a very close family, and in this last season, they've been in Omaha where Jack retired from the Marines, and they've been there since. But in August of 2019, everything changed. When Christy was driving their four kids, and she stopped at a stoplight, and the dump truck that was behind them had a distracted driver who didn't stop. And after colliding into their car at 45 or 50 miles per hour, Christy has no memory of what happened next. She woke up in the hospital, and as soon as she woke up, she immediately started asking, you know, how are my children? And no one really wanted to answer until her husband showed up. Jack came in the room, and he told her that that Abby and Stephen had passed away. And after suffering such incredible loss, Christy and Jack had to do what no parent should ever have to do. And they started preparing a funeral for two of their children. But as they grieved at home, they made a choice. They made a choice to play worship music night and day. They made a choice to fill their house with the praise of the Most High and to believe in His promises and to trust that He was good. And while they were streaming different worship songs on YouTube, a song popped up, and it was a song that they had heard the lyrics of a few weeks before on the radio, and they didn't know what the song was, but then as soon as they heard it on YouTube, they're like, that's the song. That's the song we're gonna play at our children's funeral. And on August 15th, 2019, the young family lifted their hands in praise to the Lord as they sang, "Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. For all my days, yes, I will." And after the funeral, the Spirit moved, and a group of young people chose to put their trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. This happened after the funeral was over. There's the picture of the students, the young people, giving their lives to Christ. And that was just the beginning of the many ways that the Lord would use this sweet family for His glory. When I spoke to Christy on the phone this week, I couldn't stop crying because of her amazing hope. She was ministering to me. Hearing her voice, she was filled with hope and love for the Lord because she doesn't place her hope in the circumstance of her valley. She doesn't place her hope on being able to understand why this has happened. She chooses to trust in the Lord every day and worship Him for His goodness and greatness. Christy's a part of a Facebook group for grieving the loss of children, and I wanted to read you a post she wrote recently. She says, "Friends, I want to share this song with you. We chose this song for our children's funeral with tear-filled eyes and lifted hands, sincerely meaning every word. We did our best to sing. Life often takes you to crossroads, pivotal points where our response determines our way forward. Hurts, disappointments, and personal failures happen as regular fare in a fallen world. How we respond to that is what matters. The same event that could soften and grow us could anger and harden us. We can yield to God or bolster our position and allow anger and bitterness to compound damage." Some of the lyrics of this song I share with you say, and she puts in all caps, "And I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand against. For all my days, yes, I will." And here is a picture of the young family this year. And you can't see it, but in the clouds, they put a little watermark of Abby and Stephen, now that they are in the presence of the Lord. And there's a family who's walking through the valley. There's a family who's still walking today. They're trusting God, with God as their provision, and with God by their side. And when I asked Christy this week, I said, "Christy, how do you keep walking?" And she just quickly answered, and she said, "Well, it's very easy, Eddie, it's very clear in this sense. You have to surround yourself with God's people, and you have to spend time in God's Word." She did everything she could to be in God's presence, to be in God's Word, and to be with God's people. That's how she kept walking. And my encouragement to you today is the same. Whatever valley you're walking through, keep walking. Keep walking. By being in the presence of God, by being in His Word, and by being with His people. keep walking. Let me pray for us. Father, you see every single one of us. You see the valley your sheep are in. You know the needs we have. And because you are such a good shepherd, we can say, I shall not want. It's not because of our circumstance that we say that. We say that because we know you. We know the shepherd that you are. And because of who you are, we can say with joy in our hearts, we shall not want. We will have the care that we need because we belong to you. Holy Spirit, comfort and encourage everyone today. Give us that hope that what we're walking through is not forever. It's not forever. But while we're in it, God, we're going to keep walking. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, this week was I Will Walk Through the Valley, and next week will be I Will Fear No Evil. I hope you can join us next week, but as you go today, remember that you are loved.